About to mention why we are having this particular track, the mobile and IoT. Right? So this is a picture that I've taken back in about like four months' time in the conference that we have had in US, where Sanjeev was announcing some of the key focus areas for 2016. Okay? And one of the strategic things that we have decided in here is to treat the mobile and the IoT, Internet of Things, as a single package. Of course, for a marketing purpose, we will have the mobile device management as a separate product, but we are going to treat both of these areas, mobile and IoT, under a single area, single focus area. So with this, let me switch gears. IoT is not new. And why do I say so? So if you are old enough, you might have heard the term MDM, machine to machine. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen this. Like, if you have seen a very old treadmill, 25 years old, ago, you would have seen that there's this motor and there's this console where you can control the speed. Okay? And if you compare that treadmill to a treadmill that you have these days, there's a significant difference where you can plug in certain things or you can extract the data. When you run, it provides an interface where it can be connected. And it, then there are treadmills that allows you to connect that to your mobile device so that it matches the data that is coming from Fitbit. So it's a whole different connected world compared to what we have in the MDM world. Now, Internet of Things is that. The significant difference there is what is in the center, the big data part of it. Due to devices being connected, all these devices are pushing a lot of data, creating a lot of data. And that is creating a lot of data that are collected at different places. This is one of the primary differences between MDM and IoT. And actually, IoT is right at the top of the hype. This is a graph that Gartner has produced back in 2014. And say, for example, like these blue dots are actually, they are telling, will be matured in about 5 to 10 years' time. Then right? There are things like somewhere here, it says holographic displays. So the definition for this one is, it won't be mature until 10 years. Right? So as per Gartner, IoT will be matured enough to be used in production somewhere in like 5 years' time. So we are still at the hype of it. Yeah, everyone is talking and everyone is trying to do things related to IoT. Okay? And WSO2 is, of course, we are not driven by hypes, but we also want to, like, being a middleware company, we wanted to have our own share of IoT. And in order for us to do that, we kind of went back to the books and tried to understand the IoT ecosystem. And we have broken that into four pieces. Number one, device manufacturing. So the thing, it's a device that gets manufactured. Okay? And the device is actually useless without a piece of software to control it. So that is where the app development comes in. So you create a device, and then you develop an app for that to control it, one or multiple apps. Then the device actually gets, number three, device goes to the targeted audience. Let's say, like, can be the treadmill that I've spoken about. And it gets used. Then there are certain things like monitoring that needs to happen, dashboards. Okay. It's with this understanding that we came up with this particular product called WSO2 IoT Server, which is a server-side IoT framework. So to explain the concept in a easier way, I thought of like I'll take a little bit of storytelling, and I created this particular story. So Nogini.com is a manufacturer of fire safety devices. So basically, they have an array of products that are allowing people to fight fire or like detect fires at home level. Okay. So there's this user, called Sumedha, it happened to be my name, but has no relation to me, has purchased a fire alarm from Nogini.com. Okay. And he takes it home, and on top of the fire alarm, it says, register at http://nogini.com to activate. And there's a serial number. Right? Now, in this case, this particular user is the device owner who has purchased the device. Right? So he visits that particular page, and it tells, OK, if you are a new device owner, get yourself registered. So he fills it up, and there's an account that gets created. Right? Now, this is the experience that the IoT service is providing for a device owner. Right? And since it's a product that is coming from WSO2, the particular account that you create here gets created using the WSO2 identity management component. So it's a device owner who's registering, and that his account goes into the identity management framework. Once he's logged in, he created an account and he logs in. So here again, his account gets verified against the identity framework, and he'll be taken into My Devices view. So this is the first time this particular user has logged into this one, because he just bought a new device, and My Devices view is empty. Now this is a particular page that comes with the product. So he's being actually asked to, it's not clear here, but he's being asked to, okay, go in and configure your device. So to do that, he goes into the devices listing page. Right? Now, these are a bunch of devices that the Nogini.com is offering. Right? And of course, it happens to be a bunch of plugins that we have written at the server. And a full list of devices, and on top of it, he selects the fire alarm. And then it gives him a detailed instruction telling how to register. So this is a page that any device manufacturer can extend to give his instructions. And it asks the user, give a name to your fire alarm, and also enter the serial number of the device that you have just purchased. So once you do this, the user sees the fire alarm that he has just purchased and registered in his My Devices view. And when he goes to the device detail page, he would see the control operations for the fire alarm. Right? So in this case, it only happens to be a single one, where you can manually turn on and off the buzzer if the fire alarm goes for some malfunction action. And he also sees the data coming in from the device, a live stream of data. Now, I happen to mention that from device API here, because this particular page is something that is coming out of the box from the product, from WSO2 IoT server, but can be customized by anybody. So they can copy their own UI because it's powered by a backend API. And he also can send control signals to the device. Again, part of the product. And see the statistics over time. And of course, specify operation policies for the device to tell, don't trigger the fire alarm if I'm at home. And also group the devices so that, say for example, like it's very unlikely that you might have a single fire alarm for a home. So you might want to like gather multiple fire alarms and call it under, my fire alarms. Or else you might want to install different device types. It could be a fire alarm, it could be a smoke detector, it could be a motion detector for a particular area, and you might want to name that my lobby area. So the purpose of device grouping here is to give a view, give you an interested view based on what you want to monitor. So for a building administrator, it could be that a floor-based grouping. They are like first floor devices. And this is the view a device order would get. Okay. And this, of course, can be customized, or you can even come up with your own UI, because all these are powered by backend APIs. Okay. Now, the scenario is quite different when it comes to a device manufacturer. The person who's manufacturing the device. So the same ecosystem is true, but different set of challenges. So for example, if I start with the device manufacturing phase, which is over here, when a physical device is being manufactured, that device needs an identification to start with. Okay. So that identity generation itself is a challenge, because it's that identity that is being used when that device is being enrolled or registered. Then if you are manufacturing a device, if that device is supposed to talk with some other systems, say for example, if you're building up a thermostat, that thermostat might want to talk to some other weather service, a software service. So integration at the device level to some other software service is a challenge that you have to solve. Then once you have the device, having applications or firmware developed is a challenge that the device manufacturer needs to take care of. So you create a device, and how you get a developer, software developer, to write a piece of software to make the device useful. Then, sorry, when the device is being used by the end users, how you control device access? If I get a thermostat, I should only be able to control my thermostat, not anybody else. Same goes for a roller gate. I only need to open my roller gate, not my neighbors. And I might also like would like to have some event management. Let's say like I'm having a small party at home, and there's a barbecue. And a particular thermostat might pick up certain values. But that's not something that I want to be notified. So I might be able to do a custom policy and do event management, telling on this particular day, between this particular time, don't send any alerts. Or else, like, if the temperature is like rapidly increasing, send an alert, things like that. Then when the device manufacturer's device gets very popular and it gets purchased by many users, there's a problem of scalability. So alongside the device, he also needs to think about the software platform scalability. Okay. Then of course, security part of the data. Now here, there's a device manufacturer, and then there's an application developer, different parties that gets involved. And here, the device owner. And there could very well be device operators. So for example, if you guys can remember, when this Malaysian airline crashed, Rolls-Royce was telling they have a separate back channel to the engine's data. It's not a back channel, but basically they have installed a separate data flow that comes to Rolls-Royce to know when the engine is performing, how the engine is performing. Now, in that case, airline manufacturer is Boeing, and the owner of the airline is Malaysian Airlines. But then there was a separate operator that was involved. So different challenges that are available for device manufacturers. Right? I was actually talking to somebody from the healthcare industry, and they have purchased certain monitoring system from a certain brand. And in that case, when they clip on certain things into patient, that data, there's a problem with that data, like whether that data belongs to the patient or the hospital or to the person who manufactured the device. So different challenges that need to be sorted out. And we created the WSO2 IoT server, server-side IoT architecture to address some of these challenges. So first of all, we started with something called WSO2 reference architecture for IoT, where we have listed out how we see the challenges and how we try to solve those problems, firstly by identifying different components of this particular problem. And then we defined something called WSO2 IoT platform. So for example, this is the same analogy that we have when we compare the API management. So we have an API management platform and a particular product that is dealing with some core issues. So similarly, we have a definition for a platform, IoT platform, which is dealing with things like at the center of it, device management, then portals, displays, having APIs, then event stream management, analytics, and then things like federated identity, machine learning at the outer side. So when we talk about the IoT server, it's a selected set of some of these capabilities packaged together in a single distribution. And the target audience is three categories. First is device manufacturers. People who are manufacturing devices but not having the software platform to deal with all the challenges that I have mentioned before. So basically, we would give certain interfaces to them so that the IoT platform can be plugged into their manufacturing process. The second category is architects who wants to make use of devices. They don't want to deal with the device manufacturing, but they might want to deal with the data that is coming from devices. A very good example is like in the insurance industry. Nowadays, most of the insurers are installing devices into vehicles to see how a particular driver is driving. And they are feeding that data directly into their premium calculation system. So they are not interested in the device itself. All they are interested in is the data feed. And third part is WSO2 internal cloud. Basically, we are planning to have our own device cloud. So as of now, it's supposed to be available in GA form by 2016 quarter one, oh, sorry, quarter two, early stages of quarter two. And it's a single pack having some of the capabilities that I mentioned here. Actually, all of the capabilities that are in this circle. And there are certain challenges that we as WSO2 had to face when we want to implement this particular product. Those are actually not challenges, but certain things that we have to consider, certain things that we have to think through. So primarily, we are a middleware platform. And for a middleware platform to be an IoT platform, there are certain additions, specifically in the areas of device management. Now, these device management challenges appear in different phases. So for example, if I start on the manufacturing phase, for a person who's manufacturing the device, like I said before, getting those IDs that needs to be burned into the device. So how a software platform issue those IDs and make sure that those IDs are continued right throughout the life cycle of a device. And then when the device is deployed, keeping track of where the device is, keeping track of what devices are close by, because some of those devices may not have GPS type of capability, so having a separate map alongside the device's ID, it's a challenge and something that we need to support from the platform. And they might also want to like map it. And then at the management and usage phase, you might want to like share the device. You might want to selectively share certain part of the device's control. You might want to selectively share certain part of the device's data. So the product needs to support that. Then troubleshooting phase. You may have deployed like 1,000 devices and 10 devices out of those may be faulty. So how to identify? How to identify a particular device that is giving abnormal values? How to identify a device that is stolen? So different challenges that we had to take into consideration when building this particular product. Some of those we have solved, some of those yet to be solved. And in order to solve some of those challenges, what we did was we created something called Connected Device Management Framework. Now, at the very beginning when I had that slide where Sanjay was presenting, the first line, I don't know whether you guys have noticed, but first line was having a single framework that deals with core device management challenges. Then on top of it, have two products, one to deal with mobile and the other one to deal with the IoT, specifically to serve two different markets. But technically, we are actually building on top of a single code base. Then, with this particular framework providing some of the device management capabilities, we create the IoT server, embedding this particular capability and other capabilities that are available in the platform like API management, service deployment, analytics, all that into a single package. And when you want to understand the IoT server, or like if you are a device manufacturer or if you are an architect, enterprise architect, there are certain core concepts that are important and that are behind the product, which will help you to understand the product better. So the first thing is it's a framework. Because WSO2 is not in the business of manufacturing devices, we can't be like writing piece of code that will work with any device. What we can of course do is like take a couple of devices and write a certain side of things to tell, locate, or to show this is what it is. And if you are writing your own device plugin, this is what you have to do. But it's more of a framework. So you have to extend if you want to plug in your own device. And how you extend that is in the form of a device plugin. So this particular device plugin has four main sections. First one is the plugin that you write to the device management framework, which tells, okay, there's this particular device of this particular type. Let's say you are manufacturing a fire alarm, right? So you need to write a plugin that explains what the fire alarm is. So the fire alarm can be having a temperature reading, and it can also be having a buzzer, right? So you need to tell that to the system. And then there's a control API that represents the device's functionality. Third one is analytics scripts. When you receive certain data from fire alarm, right, what are the analytics scripts that needs to run? Like how to process it, how to summarize it, how to receive events, when to trigger certain things. That needs to be part of the plugin. And the last part is, if you are using WSO2 IoT Server's UI framework, the UI component, that needs to be shown up when somebody clicks on the particular device type. So the plugin to the framework that is mentioned here is of this particular structure. And in order to facilitate writing these plugins, we have a little bit of tooling at this point. So there's a Maven archetype, and then we are in the process of plugging that into our developer studio. And then there's a comprehensive sample as well, which allows you to like write a plugin of your own. So with that, the other core concept is we see the device as this. A particular device can be having things that gets that can move, that can do certain operations. We call them actuators. So for example, if I take a roller gate, right, the motor, the gate that goes down, that's a function. That's the actuator that invokes. Then a sensor, which tells whether the door is open or not, something that we read out of from the device. Then there's a management interface that allows me to set things like, okay, for user X, don't allow the gate to be open between this time of the day. So we see the device as these three things, actuators, management, and sensors. And then we think that modeling the device as an API is a better way for it to integrate with the rest of the middleware platform. So for example, if I take this this particular example, a particular motor right at the bottom can be explained as an API like this. There can be a, as a REST API, there can be a POST request that tells the motor should be turning on this particular direction, this number of turns. Or else, you might want to have a GET operation that tells the status of the motor, whether it's spinning, or whether it's stopped, whether it's stuck, like that. And advantages of using modeling devices as APIs is like, it fits in with the existing ecosystem of developing applications and integration, because that's a standard paradigm where developers operate in. And the next key concept is different devices have different modes of enrollment or registrations. Say, for example, like Prabhat talked about Coop BYOD, which is pretty much applicable in the space of mobile devices. But when it comes to IoT devices, the list also like grows. Say, for example, there can be multi-factor enrollment behaviors. Now, this is, of course, case for, valid for mobile devices as well. There are, in order for you to register a certain device, there are different steps, certain set of sequential steps that you have to follow. And there can be dumb versus intelligent devices. Some devices are capable of executing certain things, but some devices are not. So you have to like manually do certain things. And then there can be self-enrollment, where when the device is powered on, it automatically gets enrolled or registered. Or there can be end-user enrolled devices. Or else there can be bulk enrolled devices. So for example, if you take a case of a municipal council deploying garbage bins over a town, those garbage bins, once they are put in place, there's no need of having a particular owner for a garbage bin. It's just like gets self-registered and could be pushing out data telling I'm full, come and pick me up. Okay. So these are again part of the challenges and concepts, challenges that we have considered, and part of these challenges are solved using certain API operations, certain capabilities that are within the platform. I just happened to, so there are two ways of spelling enrollment, English and British way. And then application management of those devices, like what is running on those devices, and or even the firmware management. This is not something that we are like dealing with in 100% way at this point, but we have a product called App Manager, which is offering capabilities of managing applications running on devices. So it's not up to the firmware level, but that particular component can be used to manage and see what are the applications that are running on a particular device, whether it should be pushed an update, etc. Then, part of supported protocols. Now, this is a very subjective thing. So, based on the device's capability, based on the type of scenario, you might want to, you need to select the appropriate protocol. So, as of now, we do support MQTT, XMPP, WebSockets, and HTTP as part of the framework. But this can be extended based on the device's requirement. There is actually a customer who has expanded this framework to support Sigfox. It's not publicly available, but they are willing to expose it in within a couple of months' time. And then there are security considerations. Say, for example, in the case of like allowing devices to be accessed. So these actually are some of the like core concepts. Using a token-based mechanism to grant access to devices. So OAuth can be a good candidate. And if you want to share devices with someone, Uma can be a good candidate. And if you want to, that is device access, if you want to share device data, it can be via an API based on certain sharing mechanism. And then multi-tenancy. Again, a challenge and part of the problem that we have solved in the platform. Okay, so this is actually an extension of the same concept. So security challenges available at different levels. It could be at the device level, it could be at the communication layer between the device and the IoT platform. It could be within the IoT platform itself. So you need to, when you are writing the plugin, you need to take this into consideration. It is not part of the solved within the platform, but rather something that the plugin author needs to take into consideration. And I'm not going to talk about this a lot because Anjan is going to talk about this. But basically, in the case of devices, these four things matter when it comes to analytics. How fast you want to see things, and what is to keep, and then giving a current view of things or a prediction of things, and whether to act on something that is happening on top of the device. So all this is powered by capabilities offered by the data access server, complex chain processor, and the machine learner. Anjan will talk in more details. And finally, if you are an architect from an enterprise, how you can use the IoT platform? So several ways. One is you might be looking for a device management solution. They are like you are enrolled in different type of devices and you want to write your device management on top of the platform. Or it could be that you're already having devices and there are new protocols that needs to be supported. So you might want to run develop a protocol extension where your devices can now communicate to a broader integration platform. It could be that performing analytics on top of existing data. In that case, you don't want to do any device management, but you just want to receive data and perform analytics on top of that data. And it could be that you have the device and you want to integrate that device into a broader system. In that case, it's a device to integration to some other system. Or it could even be from one device talking to another device via an integration platform. And lastly, it could also be you have a device, but you want to manage the application lifecycle management via the platform. So these are some of the use cases that we envision where WSO2 platform will be used. Okay, that's what I want to present. And if you guys have any questions, I would like to answer.